is set to get costlier starting April 2018. The finance minister has proposed in the union budget to tax long-term capital gains on the income that you earn from mutual funds.
The centre in its budget announcement on the 1st of Feb 2018 proposed long-term capital gains tax on equity holdings. Profits essentially made on sale of shares on or after April 1st, 2018 will be taxed at 10%.
The proposal has the middle class worried, who are now scrambling to take stock of their gains on savings painstakingly invested over the last many years. People, in fact, are also reconsidering their investment plans as the new financial year dawns.
They should reconsider this. It is an untimely thing. They should give some roadmap.
Opposition leaders, too, have strongly objected to the move.
I would not oppose LTCG in principle, but I would seriously question whether this was the year in which you should introduce LTCG.
But despite the outcry, the government defending its move, finance minister saying that it was need of the hour and Indian markets are strong enough to weather a few days of correction.
When you impose even a 10% long-term capital gain,
that's right, yes.
I grandfathered whatever was the existing protection. Mm. Most people were expecting this to come sooner or later.
True.
To the middle class that was largely ignored this budget, to the Aam Aadmi who's burdened by rising inflation and static salaries, the tax on long-term capital gains has come as an unkind cut. Mirror now asks, will the government consider differentiating between the small investor and the heavy rollers while levying LTCG? Will the government make it worthwhile for the Aam Aadmi to invest? Why penalize the small investor? Let's debate.
You're watching The Urban Debate. I'm Fede Souza. Thank you for joining us. This is Mirror Now. This is part of our appeal to the Finance Ministry to reconsider the tax on small investors. While levying long-term capital gains tax on equity, please make a differentiation or a distinction between the people you were hoping to target and those who are putting aside their life savings over the long term. That's the case we're building today, and we hope that our voices reach the Finance Ministry. Please pick up the phone and call us. We also have excellently educated, eminent voices to help us understand what impact this will have on us. Joining me on the show, Dhirendra Kumar, the CEO of Value Research, Mohan Guru Swami, founder of the Center for Policy Alternatives, Zafar Islam for the BJP, Shailesh Gandhi, former Chief Information Commissioner, Karthik Zaveri is an investment advisor, Abhishek Rastogi is a tax partner at Khaitan & Company. Gentlemen, thank you so much for joining me on the show. I'm going to start with Dhirendra Kumar. Dhirendra Kumar is widely accepted as the most respected voice when it comes to investments in mutual funds for the retail investor. Dhirendra, we spent some time today talking about the impact this will have on different kinds of investments and different kinds of investors. And we've received phone calls from people who are now worried, they're panicking, they don't know what to do. Do you think this was badly timed? Or do you think there's a case here for the ministry to perhaps make a distinction for small investors?
Yes, absolutely. It spoils the interface, you know. The mutual funds were just making inroads. Never in the past we have seen this kind of domestic investors' interest in market through mutual fund. It is happening in a fairly steady way. The SIP momentum, you know, which is gradual investments in mainstream fund, and they are not necessarily all equity. It just turned out, and this creates friction. It creates a tax arbitrage. Let me explain these things, this to you. Today, you know, when you go to, when you tell somebody that, you know, invest in mutual fund, the massive campaign, mutual fund Sahi is on. For the first time, we have witnessed that the market is, you know, sustained by, continuous inflows from domestic investors. It is primarily through mutual funds, through their regular investing. It's almost like a recurring deposit in markets. And one key charm was that even a balanced fund with 65% and more in equity, remaining in fixed income, one was able to, you know, pursue, because Indian investors have been historically fixed income investors, the high return that was prevalent, even though sometimes it was negative return, they don't understand the sophisticated concept of negative real return, though the absolute real return, you know, absolute return might look handsome. Investors, and whenever in the past, in the last 20, 25 years, whenever investors came in a seasonal way, they lost, you know, it only led to erosion of confidence. They came in a seasonal way, they were not methodical, and they came only when it was inopportune to be in the market. So this is a completely discretionary, of course, this is largely catalyzed by, you know, the collapse of real estate, the decline of fixed income. So the interest rates on a decline. So investors are working hard and, you know, assuming the risk to optimize their return. And these are early days. I still don't come across, you know, I've been working in this area for nearly 25 years. Only in the last 1.5, 2 years, you come across, you know, your neighbors who say that, okay, how to get started with mutual fund. And then there are a lot of problems, you know, the KYC, getting started, choosing a fund, choosing the appropriate fund, looking for an advisor. Great deal of unawareness, you know, complete lack of understanding. So in that scenario, I think it is early days, and this causes a, you know, interface issue. Now you say that, you know, today there is another problem, you know, regulatory arbitrage that has been created that today, okay, we'll talk about it later.
So I think the point that Dhirendra was making was the fact that under the insurance regulator, insurance policies, ULIPs are not being taxed, but mutual funds are being taxed. And that doesn't make any sense. Karthik Zaveri, do you also agree with the fact that people who are putting aside now long-term savings should be spared this tax one way or the other?
Absolutely fair. You know, it's been about 20 years that mutual funds is the first time looked as an acceptable form of investments. We've been explaining people concepts of retirement planning, long-term education funding for their kids, and so on and so forth. Now, all these things in a situation in India where there is inflation, there are high costs of living in cities like Mumbai and Delhi and Bangalore, etc. The cost of real estate is so high, which never ever seems to come down. In that kind of a situation, crores of rupees of corpus, if people have to accumulate over 20 and 30 years, how would that happen? People don't go into stocks because stocks is akin to something like speculation. So mutual fund has finally made an inroad with the fact that 5,000-6,000 crores of rupees was coming in through SIP route. Now suddenly, if you are going to rock the whole boat, and in some sense you're going to shake the confidence, we should understand that as a country we are extremely tax sensitive. And like I mentioned last time also, we brought in STT because we wanted to abolish long-term capital gain tax. So I think from a government point of view also, there has to be some sort of a vision in terms of how to garner tax revenue, at the same time not roll back on something that we were relying on the past. It's a small amount of money, and, you know, average about, it seems like 2 crore people invest. I've gathered data from various places. Overall exposure in equity mutual funds today is somewhere 7 or 8 lakh crores, which means on an average a person is holding 3 to 4 lakhs of an equity portfolio, and which he's trying to create his retirement and his nest egg out of it. So it is really a small investor, and even that much money you don't want to spare. Maybe STT adjusted. Okay. It's also going to affect the divestment process of the government.
Right. Let me bring in Zafar Islam. Zafar Islam, see, so I think the appeal here is very simple. Taxpayers pay tax on earnings, and then we pay tax on expenses as well. Is it necessary to take away all savings options also? So after I have paid tax on my salary and I've paid tax on everything that I have bought and used, whatever is left is my savings. Is it necessary to tax that as well, Zafar Islam?
Well, the question you have posed, the tax paid and whether it's not being taxed again on the same capital, you are investing in capital which is not being taxed. The tax is being, it is being taxed on the gain you make on your investment. So it's not that you have been taxed twice. It's only on the gains, what you gain, the long-term capital gains you make on your investment.
My question was this.
You're talking about,
I've already been taxed on that money when I earned that money in my salary.
No, as I Agreed. I'm not denying the fact. What I'm saying that if you suppose you make 200 rupees or 100 rupees, your post tax you get 70 rupees, and 70 rupees you invested, and as long as it remains 70 rupees, you are not being taxed. But if 70 rupees makes 200 rupees, then there is a tax on only the additional amount you gains you make on the investment of 70 rupees. So where is the question of you are being targeted twice or taxed twice? It's only on the capital gains. And let me also tell you that small investors, I mean, if you do the analysis, the small investors have been the kind of investors who have been participating in mutual fund. Their analysis has been done, and the mutual fund industry people are here. The small investors have been exempted. Those we feel where the Honorable Finance Minister has done the Ministry of Finance has done the analysis, and they have been exempted. 1 lakh rupees have exempt capital gains have been exempted, but there are people who are making huge gains, and that huge gains, if they pay 10% on that huge gains, one should not be overly worried, because secondly, because it is a growth. Even if it's the retirement money, but it's they are putting in the growth capital in a market where it should grow. Otherwise, they could have simply invested in a fixed income instruments. Since they are taking a risk and
Zafar Islam, forgive me.
India has a lot of opportunities and the equity capital.
If someone is taking the risk, all the more reason why you shouldn't tax them, because they are already taking risk. And when someone invests in an equity mutual fund, it's money invested in the country. As opposed to buying gold and locking it up in our lockers, it's money invested in the country. So your justification doesn't hold here. I'm very sorry. And to say that 1 lakh are very rich, very big people, somebody who puts 2,000, 3,000 rupees...
No, don't interrupt me.
Someone who puts 2,000, 3,000 rupees in a mutual fund every month in order to save to buy a house, when they sell all those mutual funds to buy a house, of course their return is going to be more than 1 lakh rupees. That's the whole point of making the investment. You cannot punish someone who's investing for the long term in the country's future. This is short-sighted. And your justifications, if these are the justifications that have come from the finance ministry, they don't make sense, Mr. Islam. I'm sorry.
No, Mr. Fai, you can have your opinion, but all I'm saying that the investment amount, you have to compare with all the investment opportunities an individual has. An individual, when the long-term capital gains people have made in equity market long back, they were not participating because they felt that it's a risky investment. I'm coming to that point of risk, whatever risk analysis I was talking about. But they feel that even though if one takes risk, the amount of appreciation, capital appreciation on their investment is huge, and they have seen in last several years that market has gone up and is going up because India offers a lot more opportunities. That's why instead of taking risk on their retirement funds, not taking risk, they are taking risk because they feel that this should be put as a growth capital because it will generate a lot of good return. And on that return, they will only the return they make, they will have to pay 10% tax.
Right. Dhirendra Kumar will respond to this, and then I'll go over to Mohan Guruswamy. I know Dhirendra wants to respond. Dhirendra, do you want to respond to that?
Yeah, I've been happy to.
Yes, you know, people are not doing out of choice. They are not left with a choice. Because, you know, the fixed income return that the investors have got in all the, you know, all the investment avenues provided by the government and the bank deposit, their return is negative. The real rate of return is negative. So they have been forced to assume risk. You know, somebody who has saved his life, you know, money
Don't mislead people. Please don't mislead people.
Zafar Islam.
How can you say that today the real rate of inflation is negative?
Let him complete, please.
I'm not misleading people.
2014, when the inflation was in double digit.
The real rate of return on small savings.
The inflation has come off. So the real rate of interest is positive here.
No, it's not. Dhirendra, please finish. And then I'll bring in Mr. Mohan Guruswamy.
It is positive for a short while. All I'm saying is that for all the long-term savings, savers in fixed income avenues in this country have been shortchanged because, you know, they have their capital might be safe and the money that the interest is taxable and their net post-tax return is negative. And if you look at, I'm not talking of, you know, punters. I'm not talking of 1.5 year return. I'm not talking of last 2.5 years. I'm talking of, you know, an old person who retired 15 years back, 10 years back, and he put his money in the safest avenues. He is, his capital has shrunk and he has, and his income has reduced. So, and they have, those people are being forced to think of growth avenues to optimize their return. They are not speculators. They are, and they are experiencing these investments for the first time. And this comes as a speed breaker.
Mohan Guruswamy, would you want to respond to that? I just want to illustrate that right now the fixed deposit returns are close to about 6.75. Inflation is at 4.88. Then there's taxation. So where is the positive return? Mohan Guruswamy. Mohan Guruswamy, go ahead, please.
You know, basic philosophical issues here. Must income be taxed? If income is to be taxed, then why exempt some income? Now, this reason why long-term capital gains was exempt was that it was felt in 2004, the number of new players in the stock market, people are dissuaded from coming to the stock market to encourage them to come to the stock market. Now, we've got a certain threshold of retail investors, almost 35 to 40 million people are in this. And then you've got, you know, increase in mutual funds coming in. Just last year, you had 14 million new mutual fund players coming in. And so, you know, government wants to tap it. And the amount of revenue lost is estimated that last year on account of this was close to 60,000 crores. Now, after all, you know, there is tightness in the budget. You have no money for capital investment. Government has to keep raising money all the time. And if it raises money to the detriment of new investment, then it's something which is questionable. But if it's raising money to make new investment in other areas, then, you know, we have to look at this very carefully. All of us lose in paying any income tax on fixed deposits, on property, capital gains on properties, on rent, on everything we lose money. We can't see that, you know, certain kinds of investments will be exempt. It's a difficult case to make. But on the other hand, a lakh of rupees, maybe they could have raised the exemption to 2 lakhs of rupees. Maybe that would have made the blow somewhat softer. But I think to say that there can be no capital gains at all.
Mr. Guruswamy, we're not saying that there should be no capital gains at all. In fact, the budget speech very clearly lists out who this is targeting. They talk about the fact that there are large companies who are investing in equity instead of creating jobs. And that is what they want to target. Now, there should be an easy way for the government to distinguish Absolutely. Between these large companies and someone who's putting 2,000 rupees in an SIP every year so he can buy a house 10 years down the line, or he can send his daughter to college 15 years down the line. They should be able to tell the difference between a big corporate and a small investor. I'm going to bring in Abhishek Rastogi. Abhishek Rastogi, where do you stand on differentiating the small investor from the big corporate when it comes to long-term capital gains tax? Our appeal to the finance minister is to roll it back from small investors, please. Abhishek Rastogi. Shailesh Gandhi.
I think I agree with Mr. Guruswamy that taxing long-term capital gains is necessary because government has to collect tax. We can keep cribbing each one saying, I don't want tax. But I'm a little amused at the fact that nobody's mentioning, everybody acknowledges the fact that fixed deposit interest rates are down and the effective return is negative. Despite that, I didn't hear anyone say that maybe interest income from fixed deposits should not be taxed at all, especially for senior citizens. That's not a point anybody's making. It's as if mutual funds are very special. Fixed deposits, which are normally what most senior citizens would put in because they don't want the risk, and it's perfectly legitimate. And they've made that money out of their savings and earnings. And Faye, I think I agree that all money that you earn pays tax, and only income out of that is taxed. It is not as if the same money is being taxed over and over again. So that's a fair point Mr. Islam makes. I genuinely believe that there is no problem in having long-term capital gain. Whether the exemption limit should be raised from 1 lakh to 2 lakhs or maybe even 3 lakhs is okay. But I think I wish people were to also talk of the fact that fixed deposit interest should also be exempt from tax to a much larger amount, especially for the senior citizens.
All right, Karthik Zaveri, do you want to respond to that?
Let me, let me just come here for a moment.
Hundreds of people that we have been working with.
Yes, Karthik Zaveri will respond and then you can respond to both of them, Mr. Islam. Karthik Zaveri, please go ahead.
Yeah, so what I was saying is hundreds and hundreds of people in this country where we have advised and we have met these people, you know, most people in India do not have the wherewithal through fixed income or any other method to be able to achieve whatever they want to do for themselves, for their children, for everyone else. In fact, here we should have a system by which we incentivize people to go and invest into equities, into mutual funds, because that's the only way by which they can create long-term wealth. Real estate does it, but it has its own share of problems and litigations and all of that. So here, what is happening is somebody who's making these baby steps inside, so we are dissuading them. We don't deny there might be a need to have long-term capital gain. Government has to raise money. Then there are corporates who have alternate minimum tax. So the companies who are only investing into stocks or a large percentage of their income is coming from share market returns, there is a method of taxing those companies also. My point here is, why tinker around with the small investor? Can we not make a distinction? Companies, let them pay tax. There's already a mechanism, AMT. And on the other side, the small investor can continue to do it because this is the only and the most effective sure shot method of generating long-term wealth. Even the US example, if we take, almost 38% of retail investors through their 401k plans, etc., are investing in the stock market because that's what creates long-term wealth and fulfills their needs. Fixed income does not. Bonds do not. Corporate bonds, bond market, debt markets have very limited use. So senior citizens have already finished most part of their lives and they need a passive income. But the younger generation needs to create a much larger corpus so that they can survive in addition to their jobs and their businesses and whatever they might be doing.
All right, Mohan Guruswamy is going to respond to that. Mohan Guruswamy, please go ahead.
Deposits in banks.
As a senior citizen, I'm all in favor of, you know, exempting senior citizens from all forms of taxation, you know. I think we've done our bit for the country. We've paid taxes over our entire working careers, and you know, I think time to for the country to give us a break. You know, I think I agree with Mr. Gandhi on that. But to have the same rates for senior citizens as for others, and also by not raising medical limits. For instance, at this age, you hit all kinds of serious medical problems, which costs a huge amount of money. And if you get an exemption of only 60,000 rupees, that's not going to do you any good. You go to any hospital today, the medical care is huge. You enter into an ICU, they hit you for a lakh rupees a day.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, some consideration should be taken to this important constituency.
Why?
Almost 11% of the population now. And, you know, many of them who are being idle go out and vote.
Yes. Go ahead, Mr. Islam, go ahead. And I also want to put on the screen what happened to the stock market.
Has to be taxed. You know, I think two, five.
Yes. Mr. Islam, will go ahead. Mr. Islam, you also please note what happened to the stock market over the last couple of weeks. Yes, go ahead. Go ahead, Zafar Islam.
No, let me respond to that. And please allow me, at least give me some time to respond.
Sure, go ahead.
First of all, see, the budget did consider, and the Honorable Finance Minister did pay attention to the requests made by the senior citizen, and a lot of exemption have been made. That whatever headroom was available, that exemption have been made for the senior citizen in this budget, and that distinction have been made for, between the senior citizen and the rest. So at least to that extent, Mr. Guruswamy must be happy. But coming back to the long-term capital gains tax and the equity versus debt, let me ask you,
from 60,000 to 80,000,
in terms of mutual fund, sir. No, but then the same yardstick, sir. If I ask you, if the Namo Healthcare scheme, which has been announced for medical 5 lakh insurance for medical care, something people have not appreciated. People are even complaining about it. You yourself, as a senior citizen, well, you have a credibility.
No, I think
and
I think it has not been appreciated.
If you
it has not been appreciated
about
because
the people who have been given.
You know, it has not been appreciated, Zafar. It has not been appreciated because there's no preparation done, no money has been allocated. You know, the calculations are out of control. You know, if you're providing 50 rupees a head, you won't get any insurance. Each person, an individual who takes medical insurance for 5 lakhs rupees, it will cost them 7,000 rupees a year. What, sir, are you providing? And you're talking about 500 million people.
Sir.
So first you've got to make available, sir, the money. Announcing a scheme is fine. Sir, I think it's a great idea. But put the money where your mouth is.
Right. Zafar Islam, go ahead, please. Zafar Islam.
Don't tell me.
No. I will come back to that.
There is a point which I want to make.
The funding of that insurance scheme, I can respond to that as well. But first, let me respond to. No, let me just complete. Then you can make a point.
Go ahead, Zafar Islam. Go ahead.
But the if 10 years ago, 10 years ago, 10 year ago, 15 years ago, 10 year government securities was issued at 14%. 14% today, the same securities. 10 years down the line, if you just somebody is holding that security, will make huge capital gains. Whether it's a retirement benefit fund they invest or is a simple investment they make, and if you compare with the stock market, even if you have invested in SIPs, you will get to know that without taking any risk, he has made a huge gain. So it's not that the investor has not generated income there.
No. Who has made huge gains?
In government securities.
Who has made huge gains? No, Zafar Islam, I don't understand you. People who invested in the stock market for the last 10 years have seen their way through the 2008 crash.
People who invested in the stock market have
seen their way through lots of volatility, and they have stayed strong and they have taken those risks, which is why they are being rewarded. And do you realize that when small investors put their money in the stock market, it stabilizes our economy.
That is what I'm telling you. That is what.
So why are you spooking them?
Please understand what I'm trying to tell you. I just want to make a few points. Investing in
the
stock market is a trading game. Likewise, had you invested. Had you invested and did a trading in securities, you would have also made huge gains there as well.
Investing in stock market is a trading game. Why are you comparing equity gains with trading gains?
Abhishek Rastogi at Virendra, come back to you. No, Mr. Zafar Islam, there is a difference between trading and investing. You've got it, Mr. Islam. I'm sorry. No. There is a difference between trading and investing, Mr. Islam. It's the first thing we learn when we go to, we go to courses on investments.
I think you have not understood. No, don't preach me. You have not understood what I'm trying to tell you. Compare the trading gain on a mark-to-market basis. All I'm saying, not a trader.
You don't understand. There is a 15% short-term capital gains tax.
Both places you will make gains.
We are not talking about traders.
Sir, I'm saying that at both places you will make
gains. We are not talking about traders. We are talking of long-term capital gains which has to be held for 1 year. There is already a short-term capital gains tax of 15%.
Here you are taking a trading
gain. No, you are talking of traders.
Why are you overly worried here?
No, there is no trading gain. We are not talking of trading gain. We are talking of people who invest and hold their investment for years.
Right, let me bring in Abhishek Rastogi.
Why are you confusing the topic?
Yeah.
Why are you actually taking the discussion in a different direction? Let's just understand.
We
are not talking of traders at all.
See, I completely understand the sentiments of all the people. I completely understand the sentiments of people. I just want to make few points. Let's just understand. See, this provision is both good and bad with some ambiguity. And let's just understand how the provision has come. So let's just understand how it is ambiguous. First point which I want to make is that even the finance minister used the word modest, that a modest tax has to be imposed. And there is an exemption which has been given to the extent of 1 lakh rupees. I think the first and the foremost point which the central government should do is to appropriately issue a clarification that to the extent of rupees 1 lakh it is exempt. Because if we see the provisions of section 112 capital A, subsection 2 and 2, it talks about 1 lakh rupees which will go to the normal income. And if that happens, then even to the extent of 1 lakh rupees will become taxable. If the person is in a 30% bracket, that becomes taxable at 30%. So I think that is an unintended ambiguity which has crept in. So I think as a first step, that ambiguity should be removed by the government so that there is no confusion on the first 1 lakh rupees. That's the first point. Now, that's the ambiguity. Now, let's understand the good part of this provision and the bad part of it also, and what could have been the better way. The good part of the provision is that there is a highest value which needs to be determined on 31st of January. So, which means when the finance minister has included this provision, all the money which has increased till 31st of January would not be subjected to tax. The amount or the incremental amount thereafter,
Abhishek Rastogi, after 31st of January, that's very important. Abhishek Rastogi, we understand that. Abhishek Rastogi, we understand that.
Now, the bad part is that this...
Go on, 30 seconds.
No, but that is very important. You understand that. If you understand that, then the entire difference is not subjected to tax. Only the money which increases from 31st of January will be subjected to tax. And that provision can change after 2 years also.
So Abhishek Rastogi, for an average investor right now who's putting, one second, an average investor who's putting 2,000 rupees in a mutual fund is going to now have to pay a chartered accountant to come in and do this calculation on a simple investment which should have been tax-free up until now.
I will come to a mutual fund in a moment. Just let me finish. I'll come to the mutual fund. I will come to that. Now, let me just complete. Transaction tax...
I think you have picked up the wrong question here and you are posing a wrong question, Fai.
Oh, I'm posing the wrong question. Okay, go ahead, Mr. Islam. What is the question I should be asking?
Yes. No, you are not allowing me to complete. First, you are talking about the market crash. Why you are talking about market crash? The market has crashed even in the United States. It's a Indian market is connected with the global market as well. If sentiments are in global market is bad, it impacts Indian market as well. Why are you blaming only the long-term capital gain for the market has tanked for last 3 days? Away from that, also I'm talking about when you are talking about market crash, then you are basically talking about the trading profit you are talking about. While I was based on that your statement, I said that you have to see on a mark-to-market basis where the gains have been made. Even on debt securities, gains can be made. Why do you always consider that hold to maturity? Because the pattern we have seen in the past that everybody invests in fixed income securities, individual, they hold to maturity. They held till maturity purely because they do not want to trade. And I'm not talking about trade, but every instrument where you invest has a mark-to-market value on a mark-to-market basis. And one needs to compare when you're comparing as a market, then you also compare it with the market, not with somebody which has been held till maturity. That is what the argument I was trying to make. And both the places you will see that you have on a mark-to-market, you will see a lot of gains. Like, for instance, if you invested in security in 14% Government of India securities, which has a maturity of 10 years, on 8th year, it may have the value of, it may be trading at 115, 120. So you have 15 rupees gain. But if you hold till maturity, you will only get the interest rate of 14% you are getting. So beside interest rate, you are also getting on a mark-to-market, the capital appreciation which has happened over a period of time because the interest rate has fallen. So when you are comparing two market, you have to compare two market on a mark-to-market basis, not on a, like one hold to maturity. Then what is the hold to maturity? You can continue to hold, you will also get a good return.
Okay, so since Zafar Islam, after 15 years spent in personal finance and retail investing, you believe that I don't understand this. I will not ask the questions. I will hand it over to Dhirendra Kumar. Dhirendra Kumar, do you want to respond to Zafar Islam's justification, please?
Yeah, so it's a very fundamental question, you know, that fixed income, when there was 40...
Yeah, Dhirendra Kumar, please.
As an anchor should behave.
I'm sorry.
You may like the response, you may not like the response, but your face impression was giving a very different impression to viewer and to me as well. And that's something not goes well with the anchor at least. You have to listen to everyone. You may appreciate, you may not appreciate.
Dhirendra Kumar, please.
Okay, I'll just bring in the context because, you know, of course, 15 years back, we had very high interest rates. But that was the norm. Market was not democratized. You know, we had Government of India bond, which was yielding 11% tax-free and all that. But that was at that time, it was in the context of that inflation. Interest rates set by government is very much in line with the then prevailing interest rates. And there is a capital appreciation or depreciation depending on how interest rates move, and so bond prices change. But you know, we are talking of, you know, a country where equity investing is not the way. Here, historically, the provident fund money gets into fixed income. The mainstream, you know, the public provident fund mobilization or the balances of public provident fund is twice the size of equity mutual funds in the country. If people, for the first time 2 years ago, employee provident fund with great difficulty started putting 5% of its money in equity. Equity is not the culture. And you know, equity is a long-term investment. And everybody who makes dedicated long-term investment, it finds its way into fixed income. The balances of fixed deposit in this country is, you know, nearly, you know, it's, you know, nothing compared to the market-linked investment. If we want a thriving, growing market, these are early days for our mutual, of our equity market, and it requires nurturing. It requires, and for the first time in 1.5 years, we see something happening. Long-term capital gains exemption was very much in line with that. Looking at the spirit of it, I think it looks, untimely. Then we have created different kind of, you know, tax arbitrage, regulatory arbitrage, so to say. When I was talking about, you know, ULIPs, it is 90% investments like mutual fund, 10% is insurance, and it will be completely exempt. And, you know, when you are talking about these long-term bonds and, you know, despite all that, you know, we have senior citizens on this panel. Despite being risk averse and putting your money in the highest yielding fixed income, you will end up being poor despite having the money, because if you consume all the capital, all the income from that, your capital remains constant, and 5 years from now, you can't beat inflation with fixed income. To beat inflation, you have to assume risk, and that has to become a mainstream way of savings and investment. This is the point, and this requires nurturing, encouragement, and that is the only point I'm making.
Mr. Guruswamy, I'm coming to you on this, and Dhirendra was right. I was part of it, Dhirendra was as well, Karthik was as well. Over the last 15 years, we've spent a lot of time working with people like AMFI, encouraging investors to start using mutual funds, to start investing in our stock market instead of buying gold and locking it up in their lockers. Now, those small investors who have an average ticket size of 70,000 rupees, should we make an exception for them, is my question.
Mm-hmm. No, you see, the tax is on income after January, value addition after January 10th or whatever, you know. But so at this moment, it's not a big incidence. Maybe even Sensex goes up to 40,000 next year or 45,000, then you know you're talking about an incidence. But therefore, I think just like you give capital gains exemption for buying another property, fund you sell, buy another one, go higher up, you get an exemption. I think you should give some creative incentives here for people to migrate from, say, one share to another share, you know, based on the value and what they expect from that share. I think something of that sort should be considered, but to be grossly unfair, to say that, you know, only you will be taxed and you won't get this exemption, I think some is a little unsettling. But I think the limit can be increased. You know, after number of people who are going to make that kind of over 1 lakh rupees in the share market a year, not going to be very much. But you can take it up to 2 lakhs or so, and the amount of money the government will make his money from the mutual funds, will make his money from the foreign investors who are buying and selling all the time. I think you can give some exemption to small investors, to retail investors, individuals, you know, people who come on their own to buy shares. And you know, who invest in stock. I've been invested in some companies for almost 30 years now.
Yes.
I dread to sell the shares now because the whammy I'll get hit by. I'm not going to put into another share in another company. I think some things can be done. And I think, but to say that long-term capital gains should not be taxed at all, I think I'm not in agreement with that.
Absolutely. In fact, I completely agree with you. Long-term capital gains tax is essential.
Fine.
Yes. But maybe, like Mr. Guruswamy said, we can create an exemption.
Fine. Can I just add 10 seconds only?
Yes, I'll come to you, Mr. Islam. Maybe, like Mr. Guruswamy said, we could perhaps create an exemption for someone based on the time they stay invested. For someone who stays invested for 10 years, someone who stays invested for 30 years in one particular security is obviously putting in retirement money at this point and is not looking to make a quick buck. Or if someone is selling one mutual fund and investing in another mutual fund, or sending one share and investing in another share, not taking the gains home, maybe an exception can be made for that as well. Mr. Islam, please respond.
See, you are talking about that somebody who's invested for long term, 10 years, 30 years, but their interests have been safeguarded. That's why it has been grandfathered till 31st
Mr.
of January.
Islam.
So they invested, and their investment, whatever gains again it had made till 31st of January, that will not be taxed. That is exempt from the tax. And that is something which I'm sure everyone knows, that till whatever gains you made till 31st of January,
that we all understand.
That is whatever based on the unit price.
I didn't mention that.
So number. Where is the so only after that. You make the new investment after 31st January. Yeah, so that's what.
Applicable only when STT is paid.
So where is the point?
No, I'm talking about whoever has invested.
So if the transaction is prior to, when the transaction is prior to 2004, then STT was not paid and will not get the benefit. The benefit of 31st of January gets applicable only when STT is paid at both the ends, at the time of acquisition and at the time of sale. So for the shares which were purchased prior to 2004, there was no STT applicable that time, and it goes to a higher tax bracket. So that statement is incorrect, that it gets applicable to all. It gets applicable only to shares purchased on and after 2004, not shares purchased 20 years back.
All I'm saying that the tax, the gains what they have made, that has been grandfathered till 31st January.
Karthik
but one thing which I want to say, that here also it has been, see, the, one can argue that whether it's 1 lakh, 2 lakh, as Mr. Guruswamy was saying.
The devil is in the details, that's right.
The distinction has been made.
The benefit gets applicable only for shares purchased on or after 2000.
Dhirendra wanted to come in. Dhirendra, what devil is in the details?
The devil is in the detail, because long-term capital gains exemption, which was applicable till 31st of January 2018, assumes that if there is any transaction which does not incur STT, because STT was initiated only from 2005. So all transactions prior to that will not be, grandfathering of all the investments or all the gains will not be applicable on that. Till 2004, and that is a different point altogether. The point is that it has been grandfathered so far, but there has been so many changes, and that is one part of it. The key point is that do we really want long-term investors and young investors? I'm not talking about the past, but people who should be investing. We had a whole generation who were well off, and they were fixed income investors,
and
they are ending and they are getting older and poorer. That is one thing. If we really want to change that, then it requires encouragement, because people don't understand market-linked investment. If they understand, they understand it wrongly. They become a trader. They end up losing money. Here is a great vehicle which is helping people, and it's helping government. The market is prospering for the first time. We have seen that the FII's impact was so marginal. Government has succeeded with the disinvestment entirely because the market is booming. 14,000 crore has come in Bharat 22 as part of the disinvestment program because of a roaring market. So I think, when you look at the side benefits and when you look at this trivial thing, which is, taxing long-term, maybe, last year itself, government introduced a tax of dividend received by individuals. And there the ceiling was kept at 10 lakh rupees. So that will, we should understand the dynamics of that, how people save and it accumulates into something sizable, what part of it is gain. And the most funny thing that we come across here is that even the inflation, which is part of the gain, will also be taxed. It is not going to be indexed, which is a very core principle of any capital gains taxation. You buy a house, you sell a house at certain point, you adjust your purchase price by the inflated cost.
Yes, that's true. You will not be able to adjust this short-term capital, this long-term capital gains tax for inflation either. Karthik, I'm going to come to you. We have somebody on the phone line, Vishal Rao on the phone line from Bangalore. Vishal, go ahead.
Yes.
Yes, go ahead. What's your point?
My point is I just started investing in MFs.
Yes.
Since October last year.
Okay.
It's been like, you know, 3-4 months and this 10% tax on MFs, long-term capital gains, is a setback for us.
Yes, it is. Karthik's a very good response. Karthik's a very, investors are going to think it's a setback. And to respond to what Mr. Zafar Islam said, the benefit of investing for 20, 30 years is something that every Indian should have. It's a benefit that we're now going to discourage. So a young person who's now considering this option is going to say, if I take this investment and start today, I will have to pay tax. If I take a mutual fund or a stock and it doesn't do well and I want to shift to another fund, I will have to pay tax. If I take out a little bit of money, I'll have to pay tax. So that is going to discourage investors from entering the market. Karthik Zaveri.
Absolutely. It was a great deterrent, and you know, like I completely agree that we should be reverse. So can I please finish? In fact, there should be a huge incentive. There should be a huge incentive for investing for a long-term period. You know, I want to give a slightly different perspective, and my sentiment goes out with people like Vishal. So many people will think it's a deterrent. They'll stop doing SIPs, and which is actually not very good. But think about it. The Honorable Finance Minister said that in the last year's return, they found 3,67,000 crores was the capital gains which was filed and which was out of the tax purview. But, sir, think about it. In the last 26 years, six times, and that is in 1992, 96, 2000, 2008, 2010, and in 2017, we have seen a stock market rally where huge wealth was created. You are absolutely, all of us are right when we say that STT was introduced in 2005. Now, that was a period which was just a little bit after the Twin Tower collapse in America. And that's the time equity markets were absolutely at the lowest point ever. There was really no gains happening. There was really no tax coming out of it. And that's why it was thought to abolish long-term capital gain tax and bring STT in. So now, if in 26 years, six occasions, we have seen large amount of wealth being created, and cumulatively, that is the reward for people who hold investments for 15 and 20 years. And today, when we start giving a taxation on something like that, when we already have a STT in place, it's going to deter people like Vishal and so many young investors who are just about starting their journey to create wealth in a country like India, where it's not like the land of opportunities that America was once in the 80s and the 90s.
Yes.
We are not in that kind of a situation. Maybe we will come there in the next 20 or 30 years, but still, we have a long way to go.
So government
and all
the
honorable dignitaries there, we need to really think about it. Six times in 26 years, which
country.
Is not really.
I'm very sorry to say that.
Agree.
Yes, yes. Zafar Islam, please respond. Zafar Islam will respond.
No. Completely disagree with him and his analysis that today the youth or the youngster who want to invest will have problem because their 10% capital gains have been imposed on their income. I think this is not fair to make this kind of statement because somebody, even in a very established market in US and UK, if you see, the long-term capital gains are there as well. And the percentage is much steeper than what we have here. So it's not that this is the only market in isolation in the global economy where...
So I'm just saying it's a deterrent. It's not that they will not invest. It's just a deterrent in
many other countries. It's not a deterrent. It is not a town deterrent. No, it is not a deterrent. Especially. Let me just. If you see last 3 years number, every year the amount is increasing. And I have been told by the many market participants that people were waiting. The day it in the past, the day market used to crash, everybody used to exit from the market. And now people wait for the market to crash so that they can enter in the market. And who? The individual investor. So time has changed and the opportunities have changed. Indian economy has grown big and it has it offers a lot of potential for the equity investor. I am sure that 20 years down the line, you and I all will create wealth. And the youngster who will invest here will also be the beneficiary. So it is very unfair to say that it is a very bleak situation for youth or youngster who want to invest today. Thus will settle down after some time, because it's this very modest amount of tax which has been imposed compared to what is global market, if you global economy, many other countries, if you see the amount of tax which has been paid, and small exemption has also been given, like we have been given, and that exemption can be increased, as you rightly said, in future. If government of India feels that there is a genuine demand of the common man, and that limit should be enhanced of capital gains, could be that, as Mr. Guruswamy was suggesting.
Dhirendra?
I would just like to clarify one thing, that yes, capital gains is there in the developed economy as well, but the individual investors' substantial investment in the market is through their retirement account, the 401k plans. And those plans, and those are invested in stock market as well as mutual funds of those respective geographies. And those investments are completely tax exempt till the retirement of that person. You know, we haven't created any system in this country which will channelize long-term savings into the market, because that is a long-term savings vehicle. And we are getting after it based on some information lot of capital gains is getting generated, and we need to tax it. One third of the capitalization in the US holdings by individual investor is through their retirement account, which is tax sheltered. Likewise in the UK, likewise in Australia. So individuals in their discretionary account, that is subject to capital gains tax, but their retirement account, their long-term savings account, and we haven't provided for any such thing. We have provided something called NPS, and you know, the government employees, their money is being invested there with 10% allocation to equity, and that will be tax sheltered. We are talking of those kind of investments, individual investors' money being invested. I don't know, it's the responsibility of the government to, incentivize some mechanism of long-term savings which is tax sheltered for individuals, and that will help the government.
Let me respond to you. Last 2 minutes I have, because I have to go to another channel.
Yes.
See, you are talking about the retirement benefits and the pension plan. See, in India, if you see the investment guideline of private provident fund or pension fund, or for that matter, even insurance fund, earlier was regulated by the Ministry of Finance, even today. And there was a lot of hue and cry, even if they considered that to lower the rating. Profile of a company from AAA to AA or A+, people were not even happy to invest, and they were criticizing the government. Today you are talking about to invest in a risky assets, which is the equity considered for generating higher return, but it also you are exposed to higher risk.
Slowly,
as the market is developing, as the economy is improving, as the sentiments are improving, as the understanding of investors are improving, government is giving that relaxation. Today, provident fund, it was unheard. I have managed 5 billion of provident fund of the government of India. Earlier, it was so difficult to convince them that there are some companies which has potential to become AAA. Today, they are all AAA rated company. To invest in those companies which has a AA+ rating today, but those companies have been ignored purely because they do not want to take risk. Today, at least 5%, 10%, that flexibility is there. As we go along, market improve further, that you will see more investment in coming in equity, so that the retirement benefit, which has been tax sheltered, will people will enjoy their retirees, because it is there is exempt from tax, and those investment guidelines will undergo change.
I have to wrap up the show. I'm going to thank everybody on this panel. In closing, I'm just going to reiterate the appeal that we are making to the government of India and to the finance minister. This is our appeal, sir. Please make a distinction for small investors under the long-term capital gains tax that you have introduced. Either we could make a distinction based on the time that the person stays invested or the size of their investment. So assume someone starts today in order to buy a house 10 years from now, and he's putting aside small amounts of money. That person is going to sell all of those mutual funds in time to buy their house, and it is going to be above 1 lakh rupees. Let's assume 1,000 rupees every month at some point arrives at 1 lakh rupees. That person makes a profit of 1 lakh. When you take away 10,000, that's a lot of money in someone's hand. The other thing to look at is if someone has invested in mutual funds and decides that this fund is not performing well, I need to shift to a better fund, we can't tax them on that exit. That would be unfair. Our appeal again is to please reconsider long-term capital gains tax in the hands of small investors. Make a distinction. There are plenty. The SEBI has a mutual fund committee. There is AMFI. There are plenty of experts to consult with who can actually draw this up. But in the meantime, people investing in balanced funds, people investing in tax saver funds, in equity funds, are going to find it more and more difficult to save for their retirement. And we're a young country. Eventually, we're going to be an old country. At that point, we better have put aside enough money in long-term equity to be able to pay for our retirements. Thanks for watching.